Jennifer Walser is the the Natural Resource Specialist for USDA's Natural Resource Conservation, or NRCS. And she's been with NRCS for 15 years as a certified planner. She's now based in Lexington, Kentucky, and she assists with providing guidance and support in conservation planning on organic farming operations for employees throughout the state of Kentucky. Originally from Northern California, Jennifer has a background of working with organic farms, dairies, and sustainable vineyards. At OAK, we've had the great pleasure to work with NRCS and Jennifer specifically, and we're just so impressed with all she's done for farmers and NRCS staff here in Kentucky. So Jennifer, it's all yours.
Thanks, Brooke. Good morning, everyone. Thanks for joining. I will share my screen here so we can get started. And as some of you will see in the chat, that Sonia has also joined us. She is also out of our Lexington office, and she'll be helping to answer some of those questions as I talk through the slides. So hopefully you all can see the slides okay?
Yep.
Okay, we'll get going. So today what we're going to talk about is a little bit about NRCS, about conservation planning, how it could benefit an organic production like your own, and you know, what we all do here at NRCS with all of our acronyms. We'll hopefully keep the acronyms to a shorthand version as much as possible. So I'm going to talk a little bit about our mission, conservation planning, that is the core of what we do here, and the practices that go along with planning. And of course, at the end, we'll talk a little bit about the financial opportunities to help with all these conservation practices, and a multitude of resources that we have available to you all. Let's first start off with what the NRCS mission is. Our mission is that we deliver conservation solutions so agricultural producers can protect natural resources and feed a growing world. Our vision is a world of clean and abundant water, health, soils, resilient landscapes, and thriving agricultural communities throughout voluntary conservation. I really like to underscore the voluntary part. That's one of the reasons that I've been with this agency for as long as I have is, like many of us that work for NRCS, we're really here wanting to help you and not be any type of regulatory environment. So although we are the federal government, we are actually voluntary. So if you would like our assistance, we are available to you, but you don't have to work with us, which is really nice. So next, we're going to do a little bit of an introductory video. It's just a few short minutes. So I'm going to let this play, and then we'll come back to the slides.
Jennifer, it looks like it's loading. Is it?
Working by lamplight, before the sun rises in a Northern California vineyard. Gathering eggs for market on a New Hampshire poultry farm. Inspecting cover crops on a Wisconsin field. Growing organic produce and raising chickens in the middle of Atlanta. A late afternoon grain harvest in Washington State. And sunset with cows grazing on a Vermont hillside. This is what organic agriculture looks like in America. And these are the farmers and ranchers helping to meet the increasing consumer demand for organic products in this country. To be certified organic, producers follow regulations outlined by the USDA's National Organic Program. The USDA's Natural Resources Conservation Service can help both certified organic and transitioning producers with voluntary science-based conservation practices that enhance biodiversity. Mimic nature and utilize natural processes. These can include the use of cover crops, crop rotations, and nutrient management plans to help build healthy soils. And because organic farming is an ecologically based system, organic farmers eliminate the use of most synthetic fertilizers and pesticides, sewage, sludge, irradiation, and genetic engineering. They opt instead to work with nature, using practices like mulching, companion planting, insectaries, and cover crops to deal with weeds, insects, and disease. And since organic farmers also rely on dependable water sources, NRCS can help with effective irrigation water management plans tailored to a farm's specific needs. They can also provide support for organic livestock producers on pasture and grazing management, diverse pasture plantings, fencing, water facilities, and shelter. And NRCS can provide both technical and financial assistance with high tunnels, allowing farmers to extend their growing seasons, benefit plant health and vigor, shelter crops from weather extremes, manage pests, and help protect against drift from pesticides and pollen. Organic agriculture. It's good for you, and it's good for the land. To learn more about NRCS assistance for organic farmers and ranchers, visit your local NRCS office or find us online at nrcs.usda.gov/organic. NRCS, helping you help your land organically.
Okay, so that was just an introductory video about, you know, what we do here, especially with organics. There's quite a few other videos, and I do have links to a whole bunch of information here at the end of the presentation that you can go and look at specifically on different topics. Next, we're going to talk a little bit more specifically about conservation planning, what that looks like, and kind of demyth a little bit about our steps and our process. So oftentimes a producer will call and say that they're having challenges on their landscape and they'd like some help and assistance in figuring out what to do about that. So we have this conservation planning process that we go through with a producer on their property, and it's 9 steps. We will get into a little bit more detail on the few forward slides, the next slides, about each of these steps. But here's just a big picture concept. We start by identifying the problems and opportunities. We'll work with you to determine your objectives, inventory the resources that are out there, analyze that data, and look at different alternatives as to how to resolve the concern, evaluate the different options for alternatives, make some decisions. That's really you all making decisions on your land as to how you'd like to address it, and then assist you with implementing the plan and then evaluating how it's going. So first steps first is really looking at what the challenges are on the landscape. What could use improvement? What are you having trouble with? Walking around, talking, seeing what's been going on. Determining what the real goals are for your property. You know, everyone has a lot of different challenges usually on their property, but only so much time and energy and whatnot to put towards fixing those. So, you know, what are the real objectives over the next couple of years, especially? We look at the resources, we look at, you know, all of this list of things, soil, water, animal, plants, air, human energy. Those are all the kind of different umbrellas under which we kind of look at your property, which is probably a little bit different than the way you look at your own farm at times. So sometimes it's good just to have another set of eyes looking at it from a different objective to see, you know, what's going on and maybe how it could be resolved. And so we're going to really look at what is out there existing now and document our baseline condition. One of the tools that we use with this is our web soil survey. That's a very powerful tool that is free and open to the public on our website. I do have links to that again later on in the presentation. For you to go and look at what type of soils are on your property. We do have a whole soil science team that goes out and surveys and has mapped most all the soils in the country. We use other tools to analyze the resources. We have a multitude of acronyms and different tools that we use. One that has some specific guidance and helpful information is Russell 2, which is our soil erosion prediction tool. There is a hyperlink there to a guide on using that tool specifically on organic systems. We also look at pesticide drift, pasture condition, wind erosion. We do environmental evaluations on all the projects that we're working with you on to look at what other effects that they have on the properties. So then once we have a good idea of what the baseline condition is on your property, then we're going to look at the alternatives as, how many different options and are there to help address the concern that you may have. Especially with the organic regulations, we want to be considerate of restricting of synthetic substances, considering your three-year land transition period, and making sure that there's availability of organic seed or planting stock if we're doing any type of seeding and planting practices. And then we're going to look at evaluating all these alternatives and seeing which one would best suit your property. Then you get to have the fund decision-making process. So you get to make a decision on what you really would like to do. We put together some maps and some plans for you all so that you then have a little bit of a roadmap on what you are wanting to accomplish. And typically we look at this over, say, about 5 years, because that's a pretty good span to take on a chunk of work, and then we can come back and reevaluate. Once you've made the decision on what you want to install and what you want to improve upon on your property, then we're going to help you to implement the plan. We have a multitude of assistants here with engineers to help survey and design projects, and planners to help with the ecological practices. And then from there, once we will help with the financial on some of the projects as well. And once it's installed, we're going to come back, if possible, and if invited to evaluate the plan, see how it's working for you, make some tweaks and adjustments as needed, and then look at the next phase if that's something you're interested in doing. So this plan is completely separate from your organic systems plan. We always want to work in conjunction with your OSP plans, but they're not the same. They're not one and the same. So I just wanted to make that clarity that this is a different plan from your organic system plan, but we always want to be considering those plans and make sure we're following within those guidelines. We're not the certifying agents, even though USDA is within our name. So we always defer the regulatory questions over to those folks that are certifying you to make sure we don't get you out of any type of compliance issues. So next we're going to look at some of the practices that we do install with these plans, some of the more common ones on organic systems, just to give you an idea of what you would see out there and what we might be considering. So first we'll talk a little bit about small farms. High tunnel is probably the number one requested practice here in Kentucky on organic farms. They have a multitude of benefits. Extending the growing season, I would say, is the number one purpose that people would want to put them in this region. We do have to provide some considerations for things such as maybe we need to add irrigation now that it's covered. We always want to consider soil health. That's at the base of what we do here, and that seems to be something that we walk and think about every day. And we do want to make sure that it is a high tunnel for us is built to put plants in the soil, grow them in the soil, not on raised counters. So it's not really nursery, but rather in the ground planting. So as you can see in these photos, there is some consideration also given to the edges, the drainage, erosion around the structure itself. So it's not just the structure that we would look at installing. We would also look at other associated practices that are going to help that high tunnel be successful. Like I mentioned, healthy soils is something at the base of our agency for a multitude of reasons. It provides so many benefits if we're always considering the health of the soils, especially in an organic system, as you all know. If we don't have healthy soils, it's going to be really challenging to farm organically and keep our certifications up without anything disruptive and keeping your production up as well. So that's something that we always are trying to consider throughout many of our practices. So cover crop is another great practice that we often are looking at utilizing within the field. There is a specific resource for Kentucky that's been written with a couple of partners that you can see there, Xerces and CAT and Oregon Tilth, excuse me. And again, there's a link there to the document, but it does give some implementation guidance and suggestions on if you're wanting to install a different cover crop or a more robust cover crop in organic systems and what that may look like. As many of you probably know, some of the benefits and purposes of cover crops is to reduce the erosion, maintain your soil health, improve organic matter, improve water retention, minimize compaction. And I don't know about you, but I can tell from my little plot of land that weed pressure is a real thing out here. So to me, that is a big tool to reducing weed pressure and hopefully discouraging some of that weed seed bank. Crop residue is another great tool that we use. And specifically, we look at your crop rotation. So, you know, what are you rotating through that specific plot of land? And how can that help? How can we maybe consider adjusting the crop rotation to maybe reduce some of your pest pressure? Also, again, looking at soil health, looking at, you know, it could be nematodes, it could be multitude of different benefits, wildlife habitat, pollinator habitat to increase the pollinators. So we look at what type of rotation would be best for your site or even within certain rows that may help to benefit the landscape and your production, of course. Mulching is another great tool that we look at installing and helping you with looking at what the best alternatives are with mulch. As you can imagine, there's multitude of different options. So when we think about the different alternatives, you know, this is one of those practices that we could have multiple different ways to address mulch, but maybe in one location, it's better to do it one way than the other. Again, great for soil moisture. Here in Kentucky, I would say it also is great to help reduce the weed species surrounding your plants. I'm keeping that down so that the plants have space to room and grow and breathe. Provide erosion control. As you can see there, there's a mulch that's a little bit different, you know, that there's also many other versions of mulch, seed straw mulch and green waste and all that. Reduced tillage is another thing that we look at quite often. The reason that we would want to look at reduced tillage is to reduce the soil erosion. Again, there's a consistent theme here on soil health and soil erosion, since it is the core of what you're working with. Reducing, you know, soil sheet and rill erosion, reduce tillage also for particulate matter into the air for air quality, and to reduce your energy usage. You know, maybe that tractor doesn't need quite the diesel bill that it has had in the past. Down there at the bottom of the screen, you'll see that they've kind of done a crop rotation after a corn, then it was put into beans. So they use the corn as a mulch and direct seeded in so that it has some protection on the ground there. Biodiversity is another thing that we always want to consider as we're walking the landscape and looking at those areas that maybe aren't your most productive areas. And maybe there's a different opportunity for them in the ways of buffer strips, you know, that could be great to help with biodiversity, pesticide drift, especially for those producers that, like many of you all, don't have an organic production right next door to you. You may be really considering what you can do about reducing any type of drift coming onto your property. So a buffer of some sort is often key to those considerations and those thoughts. You know, we always want to look at the different types of site prep to really make that planting successful. That could be in the way of solarization, putting in some type of smother crop first, or mulch. Going along with the buffers, hedgerow planting is really common practice that we use. This could benefit you by providing some habitat along those edges for the wildlife, for the pollinators. It helps to, you know, maybe pull out, bring in some of those beneficial insects, or be an attractant plant to the pests that you do have, to get them off of your crop and bring them over into the hedgerow. It can, again, help stop that chemical drift from the neighboring farms or roadways. It's great for carbon storage, living fences, and it does improve the appearance. Depending on the type of hedgerow that you're looking at installing would help us to determine what type of plant species. So part of our process is not just looking at what practices you're wanting to do, but help to actually lay them out, as you can see here on this picture. You know, for example, if you're doing a pollinator habitat hedgerow, we're going to look at making sure that within your plan, you have plants that are going to bloom throughout the whole year, so that it always has some type of an attractant there to keep the pollinators there through the whole season. So that's something that's specific to your property. If pollinators are not the intent of the planting, maybe it's for, you know, beneficial insects, then we'll be looking at that as well, and making sure we don't put host species in there. So those are all things that are considered in the planning process. And with our, you know, our team of experts here between our biologists and our wildlife specialists. So soil fertility and nutrient management is another key component that we look at on the small farms and crops. With nutrient management, we're often looking at some type of a budget system and seeing what we can do to improve utilizing manure or other organic byproduct, maintaining or improving the conditions of your soil, whether they be physical, chemical, and biological. We do want to account for the nitrogen from soil mineralization. We want to make sure that we're addressing what's being put on with manure and compost, and account for any nitrogen that is either being used or provided from your cover crop. So before we offer a prescription of you know, some of these practices, we're going to look at the soil condition and make sure that hopefully it doesn't have any adverse effects to that planting or to the nutrients in your ground. Companion planting is another great tool that we have in our toolbox that's helpful for pest, breaking up that pest cycle. So with pest management, there is another example of a document there on the top right-hand corner of your screen that's been put together with NRCS and Organic Tilth, and it's on the SARE website. And it talks about practices that are specifically helpful in managing pests on your organic farm. You know, there are a multitude of practices. Obviously, pest management can be a challenge because it is a little more restrictive, of course, on organic systems. But maybe there's other ways other than, you know, finding an organic compatible spray that could also be considered, such as the practices that we've already talked about today, whether they be mulching, field borders, conservation crop rotation, or cover crop. So of course, we always want to look at trying to avoid and prevent as much as possible on organic systems. So now we're going to move over and talk a little bit about livestock and rotational grazing and other practices that we have to assist livestock producers. So at the crux of our grazing components, we always look at prescribed grazing. We want to improve the quantity and quality of your forages, protect water quality, improve or at least maintain the health of your livestock, your plants, your soils, reducing erosion, and look at the riparian habitat and watershed functions. And there's a little snippet there to make sure on the pastured animals that we meet the organic requirements. Fencing is one of the tools that we use the most for prescribed grazing to make sure that we have a rotational system set up so we can help you with fencing to install, whether it be electric or permanent or temporary. Often I've seen where, you know, you'll move electric very frequently so that you can continue to get those animals to graze across the field in a prescribed way. We often are looking also at helping install watering systems so that, of course, the animals need access to water. So the more fence we put up, the more watering systems we need to consider, make sure that they have access to what they need. Many sawmills are now starting to keep cedar posts locally to help with organic operations. So that's great information to know. And our grazing specialists can always help source some of that material if you're having a challenging time. I can connect you with him if need be. And our local field offices, of course, can assist with that. Fish and wildlife habitat is something that we always want to consider as well, if possible. Looking at those riparian areas, trying to protect them as much as we can. If it makes sense, hopefully maybe fencing them out and providing a safe home for the wildlife as well. As you all are probably aware, there's always the 3-year transition on any landscape to becoming certified organic. So one of the opportunities that we offer here at NRCS is the assistance of writing what we call a conservation activity plan, which is help with the transition on those 3 years. So there is a specific practice that we offer to help write a plan, whether you're wanting to do a full system where you transfer everything in the first year, starting on year one, so that within 3 years, your entire farm is fully organic, or if you're wanting to look at more of a gradual or split system, any of those options. So these organic transition plans are really helpful for those of you that are looking towards becoming certified on, you know, what is the best way to go about getting to that certification. We've gone through a lot of different practices today and plans. Again, we always start with the plan first and then look at practices and add the practices to the plan. And once you have a plan in place, then what? You know, how do we get it installed? The best tool that we have to offer is our Environmental Quality Incentive Program. This is a financial program, so it does help offset some of those startup costs of those new practices that you're looking at installing. We have a specific organic initiative. So it's just funding for organic and transitioning to organic farms. It is for certified, transitional, and exempt producers. So if you're exempt from needing to become certified, you can also apply there as well. We do offer up to $140,000 over 5 years. So the lifespan of the farm bill, that's how this is all funded. Of course, with any funding through the government, there's going to be some eligibility requirements. So here is a snapshot of those eligibility requirements. So you have to be an owner or an operator of the land. So you have to either have a deed or a lease of some type, be an ag producer, control or own the land, have an adjusted gross income of $900,000 or less, be in compliance with any highly erodible land or wetland requirements. And we would help you to develop the conservation plan that addresses at least one concern on the property, since that is what we're paying for, is the practices that are within the plan. How does our funding work in this program? It is competitive. So not everybody gets funded that first year that they apply, and is based on the plan and the resource concerns that you're wanting to address. Payments are made after everything is within the contract and after practices are installed. So before you start work out there on something that you're wanting to improve upon, please make sure that you reach out to us, see if there's some funding opportunities, because we can only help if it's before you've installed the practice. The rates that we pay are based on typical costs. So it's kind of a flat rate amount, depending on the amount, the extent of what you're putting in, say linear feet or acres or whatnot. Our payment rates are available online, and they are set every year, so they do adjust accordingly. In general, we have our regular program that organic producers can also apply for, which does also have a payment limitation, but that one's a little bit higher at $450,000 in 5 years. And then the organic specific contracts have that lower amount that we talked about a minute ago. During the period of fiscal year 19 through 23, organic contract payments to a person or legal entity may not exceed $140,000. NRCS accepts and processes the applications continuously. We do have what we call batching. So we take the applications throughout the year, and then at some point in that year, we'll draw a line in the sand and consider all those that have come in since the last round of funding and fund those, and then move forward with the next set. So you'll want to check with your local office as to what those deadlines are. They are set within each state. So if you're not in Kentucky, you want to make sure that you're looking at your state's information. There's been quite a few resources that I've discussed today. And so I've linked quite a few here towards the end of the presentation. So we'll go ahead and go through some of these so that you're aware of what's out there. Our number one is our field office technical guide. So this is a free website. All of these websites I'm going to talk about are free to you, for you to use. You don't need a login. You can simply go on this website, select the state you're within, and it can pull up a multitude of resources for you, whether that be our assessment tools as to how we look at that baseline condition. And most often folks are looking for what we call our standards and specifications for our practices. You know, how do we look at installing them? What are our parameters for how we put them in? And how would you go about doing that? So that's all available on our technical guides. And of course, an NRCS planner can help you through that as well. We would be providing those to you as well through a conservation plan, like we've talked about. In order to find your local service center and your local planner, you're going to want to go on our service center locator. That's the best way. We have offices in many counties. We have a representative for every single county. Myself and Sonia, who are both on this call today, work out of our state office here in Lexington, but we do have field employees stationed throughout the state that can assist you. So you would want to go onto that website, click on your state, and then you would click on your county, and it's going to tell you where all the local offices are. We do suggest, especially as we go into 2021, still with COVID going on, that you contact the office first via the phone to make sure someone's available in the office to meet with you, or to ask them. They can always just come out to the farm and meet you there to make sure we ensure any type of social distancing protocols that are in place at the time. Conservation webinars is another great option. I saw one pop up on my email this morning that's going to be this afternoon on High Tunnels. but it is recorded, so you don't need to take time away from this conference to see that. And there's a multitude of different opportunities. There's, when I looked the other day, there's 94 courses that are just specific to organic production and operation. These are all free. They're, like I said, they're pre-recorded, they're on demand. There are some live webinars that you can also sign up for if you would like. And there's way more than 94 courses. That's just the ones that were specific to organic. But that is another great resource out there where we partner with other organizations like the University of Kentucky Extension and others to provide some other technical resources for you. The USDA organic website is always a great one to look at. There's a link there to all of that information. Farmers.gov is really the home of a lot of USDA programs is shifting towards our new website called farmers.gov. So at the top there, you can tell it links other programs as well, whether it be Farm Service Agency or Rural Development or NRCS through the Conservation tab. So if you're looking for more information on NRCS, this is a great start of our most up-to-date information is going to farmers.gov and then clicking on the Conserve tab. We also have organic specific documents and support on our usda.gov/organic website. There's, as you can see kind of at the bottom of that screen, there's information on how to get started with us. There's the video that you all just saw. There's booklets and fact sheets and handouts. One of my favorites is this book called Growing Organic. We can send it out to you, but it is electronic version on the web with that link right there. That goes through the practices. A lot of what we've talked about today is also summarized in that book on how to grow organically and how we can assist you. You can always ask us for help on soil, water, air, plants, animals, energy. And oftentimes, you know, we do get hung up on that terminology. I would say the conservation activity plan is really common and popular, as well as our high tunnels, like I said earlier, and fencing and watering facilities for livestock are probably our most common practices. So this kind of gives a little bit more information about the terminology. If you're new to farming, we have an entire USDA website that helps to support your start in farming. So I've linked it here to help give you all the resources. And this is not just an NRCS website. This should also provide you any type of information on other agencies within the USDA system that can assist new farmers specifically. If you're looking to work with NRCS, there is kind of what they've laid out here as a five-step process, and it's a little hard to read, sorry about that. But again, there is a link to the actual printout document that you can get. You would want to start with contacting your local office. Let us know what your challenges are, and let's see how we can assist you. We'll come out and do a plan with you, walk and talk the property, just like we've talked about today. Get a plan together on what you're wanting to address. Apply for our funding programs. Hopefully the eligibility all clears for that. And if it's ranked well, it can get funded and then implemented.
Jennifer, we have 15 more minutes for content and we have time for Q&A as well. So I know you're getting into the resources here, but just whenever you're ready, we can move to some Q&A. So folks with us today, go ahead and if you have specific questions for Jennifer and Sonia while they're here with us, go ahead and drop them in the chat and we'll be sure to get to them when she's done with the presentation.
Thanks, Brooke.
And Jennifer, we also have that poll we can do at any time. We can do that right before the Q&A if you'd like.
Okay, yeah, I've got one last slide here because as typical, I talk faster than I think I'm going to. So we'll just wrap up with this slide, which is on crop rotation and the National Organic Farming Handbook there from USDA. But yeah, if we want to go ahead, Brooke, and do that poll, that would be great.
Jenny can go ahead and launch it. There you go. So if y'all, you should see a poll window there. So if everyone on the call can go ahead and reply to that poll, we'll leave it open for a little bit. We have a lot of folks on just so everyone can get there. We have a few options. This will help us sort of better understand who's with us. So when Jennifer's replying to questions, she can refer to specific NRCS programs that might be of interest to you. Obviously, there are different options and considerations for folks who have just crop or who also have livestock. Forestry, NRCS has a lot of support for forestry as well, and no responses there. All right. Anyone want to throw some last answers in there? I'll share the results so everyone can see them. I'll leave it open for 5 more seconds. So a few more coming in. It's so fun. Okay, I'll share the results back out with you. So it does look like the majority of folks on the call, 48% do have crop, 10% with livestock. About a third have a mixture, and it looks like about 13% are not current. I'm intuiting are not currently farming. Okay, so I'm going to stop that share, and if that box is still up for anyone, go ahead and just close out of it. It'll go away. Okay, so moving into some Q&A. Let's see, Jennifer, if you want to stop your screen share since we got through most of those resources, then we can move into a gallery view for everyone.
There we go.
And everyone can use that drop-down menu to drop into gallery view or highlighted speaker view, whatever you prefer. We do have quite a few questions, but first I just wanna say there were so many incredible resources shared during that talk. So thank you, Jennifer. Thank you, Sonia. And we did our best. Jenny was there furiously pasting the links and Katie too into the chat there. So anyone who didn't see it, you can grab those links from the chat and we'll be sure to make sure those transfer over to the recording as well. But while we're finishing up here, grab whatever you need. Those are great, great resources. So first, I guess, Jennifer, I just want to start with, before folks give you a call, do they need to have a farm number from FSA?
No, they do not.
They do not. Okay.
No.
That's a common question we have.
If you're working with FSA and you have a farm number, it's good to let us know what that is, because then we can look up some of the information already. But we can always just start from square one without a farm number. You don't have to have an established number with FSA.
Okay, great. So sorry, there's one coming through. But I guess I want to clarify, you do have to have those docs on file with FSA for eligibility for some programs, correct?
In order to have an application and actually get funded through our contracting program, EQIP, then yes. In order to write a conservation plan with us, we don't need a farm number, but if you're looking at doing any type of financial opportunity with us, at that point, you do have to work through all the eligibility paperwork and get a farm number.
Okay, great. And that the service center locator link is a great way to get started to find your local agent. And it's so amazing that NRCS agents are active and meeting with farmers even during this COVID time. So I really encourage all of you to reach out to your local agent and get to know them, develop that relationship. They're just an incredible asset. And often those service centers house both the FSA office and NRCS in most locations. So it's one number to call or one location to visit. So really encourage you to find your local agent and develop that relationship. There was a question in the chat about, it said that their local office focuses on farms larger than 10 acres. Is there any plan in the future to help smaller farms? And I just want to point out that Sonia did reply to that, saying that NRCS, of course, can work with smaller farms. So that's one of those things that happens in the myth category. And so we're just grateful for NRCS working for all size farms. So be sure to reach out to them. If you previously thought they weren't a resource for you, they are. And they actually do offer support for urban ag projects as well. So I know that there have been quite a few projects that have gone up in Louisville specifically with high tunnels, but there's all types of support. So please do reach out for them. So there's a question here. Are there any good resources for finding out what plants would be best for hedgerows, buffers, pollinator plots in a specific area? Are there resources for that, or is that something that if they were to meet with an agent that they could talk through those details?
Yeah, the best way would be to reach out to your local agent to see what is within the area. You know, we want to look at native plants. We want to look at plants that are available that are going to meet your organic requirements if you're certified as organic and that don't have host species for your location. Let me double check to make sure I didn't have a resource in here that had specific. No, it was just the cover crop one. I don't have a hedgerow one in there that I could find for locally for Kentucky.
Okay.
It'll be best to reach out to your office.
And I do want to point out here, I'll plug another session on Saturday. Matt Wilson is joining us at for a 12:55 session, and it's all about integrating perennials, tree crops into your farm for sort of that hedgerow experience, buffer experience, all of that. So agroforestry for the farm, and he's in Eastern Kentucky, so that'll be a great session. So tune into that one. Okay. I have a couple comments here from folks saying that they've had the experience where their local office or agent that they have interacted with is not as familiar with organic programs and opportunities that would fit that operation. So is there, what do you recommend for them to do? It seems like one is just sort of wondering, and another one is saying that they actually were told that that agent doesn't have that area of expertise and the conversation just stopped. So what's your advice for these farmers in terms of accessing the resources in with their local office?
Yeah, well, I will say that here in Kentucky, we haven't been great about having all those resources in the past, but we've really upped the ante in the last 2 years. That's part of how I came from California to Kentucky was I had, you know, as a field employee for 15 years in California, the majority of my work was in organic systems. So much of my hope and goal is to increase our planners' abilities and knowledge and experience with organic systems. I think sometimes some of the challenges that you all face is the fact that there's still not a ton of organic properties in each county within Kentucky, for example. And so the experiences of our field reps is often more in the conventional setting. So we're offering our field employees training every year to help increase that knowledge. If you are met with that, you know, they can always reach out to me. You can always reach out to me. We'll put my email link here somewhere.
We'll drop it in the chat, yeah.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah.
So that we can always, you know, I can always come out or I can work with your local planner to get you the resources that you need.
And I'll attest to this, Jennifer does just an outstanding job advocating for organic farmers getting these services. And she's working just so hard with her team. I've participated in some of those professional development sessions for the past 2 years that Jennifer has coordinated for statewide agents, and it's so great. And there's a lot of learning, and there's incredible opportunities for organic farmers and organically minded farmers through NRCS. And those agents are connecting the dots in terms of what programs really work for those farms. And better yet, if they don't have the answers, they're willing to go to Jennifer and say, Jennifer, what do I do here? I know Jennifer's been out to a few farms to consult on specific practices. So so if you're not getting the action you want with your local agent, do reach out to Jennifer and she'll make it happen. And I think we got her email there in the chat for everyone. Okay. Let's see. Does NRCS offer guidance or support in planning and implementing rainwater catchment systems?
Yes, we do. That may be a practice that is not as familiar to some of our agents, but we can help with rainwater catchment systems with installing those.
Okay. And what do those typically look like? Just like on a high tunnel, or what's the range of things that?
I've seen them really, you know, it's really common, especially on livestock systems, to do them on an end of a barn, to do them on the end of a high tunnel, like you said, any type of structure like that, that we can collect water off of that you could use on the during those dry periods can be considered, you know, whether we need to install additional gutters and downspouts to get it into the tanks to hold it, the piping to go out afterwards to wherever the water needs to be serviced to, are all things that we can consider. Often we might need to put down a small pad underneath those tanks to make sure that they're stable and secure. So all aspects of that we can help with.
Great. I think sometimes when folks don't know what the possibilities are, you know, it's great to hear those examples, because then they can start to think, oh, that might work on my farm, or, oh, I hadn't considered that kind of design because it was just like out of my price range to begin with. And so this is just all to say, folks, get your agent out to your farm, because they'll be able to see what the possibilities are, and they'll be able to hear from you what your goals are. And it sort of like magically comes together. It's awesome. I do want to reiterate that the CAP 138 plan is a great initial conservation planning tool for those that are organically minded and potentially seeking organic certification. That CAP 138 plan can actually serve as your application to the certifier, and it can really inform that all that paperwork that goes to the certifier. So consider that as a great starting point. There was another question here in the chat about someone looking just for more organic resources and help with organic transition and certification. So yes, reach out to Jennifer, reach out to your local agent for that CAP 138 plan that can help in that process. But I'm also gonna do an OAK plug here. Reach out to us at OAK. We have organic transition trainers, organic specialists that can work with you one-on-one. For free, as long as needed, to help you prepare for organic transition and prepare your application to the certifier, okay? And it's just, this is what we do. We've worked with 140 farmers over the past 4 years, and it's awesome. And so we're here to work with farmers who are ready to take that step. If you just have questions about the process, we're also happy to help you through that process and answer your questions. We're not the certifier, but we're here to help people get ready for that time with the certifier. Okay. Any other questions? I'm looking at the list here, seeing if there's anything in here. This isn't a question in the chat, but it's one thing that was sort of a bigger learning curve for me was when I first started doing this work, there are so many acronyms in the NRCS world that it was almost like hard to know where to start, right? I felt like I was just missing the point completely. And so I'm here to tell you all who are new to NRCS, like, be patient. They do a great job at explaining everything. And it's it's another reason to just reach out to your agent and ask those clarifying questions. Jennifer popped that great resource up that sort of explained a lot of the acronyms. Take a look at that. It's the kind of thing that people have been doing this a while, just rattle off those acronyms and it's like another language. So just take your time, ask the questions where you need to. They're here to help.
Yeah, and also to plug into that, our farmers.gov website, I think, is doing a much better job of not talking in acronym soup. So if you're looking for an online resource, especially while, you know, it's winter time and you might be more at your computer, I would start with that one, because that has a little less acronyms to read through and decipher. But yeah. Yes, we do have our own language, and sadly, sometimes we get stuck in that a little too much.
But just ask questions. Here's another question. Is it true that beginning farmers have to have 3 years of Schedule F to get financial assistance for some of the programs?
Those are good programs questions, and I am not the programs expert, to be quite honest anymore. So I don't know the current rule. We often do look at Schedule F as a way to kind of decipher if this is a backyard plot like mine, where I'm just giving it to my friends and family, or if it's an actual production. So sometimes they do require Schedule F to make sure that it is an ag production and not a backyard farm, because that is an area that we don't cost share on is like, I can't get it from my own backyard to help feed me, myself and my family and friends and neighbors. But the 3-year specific, I would have to defer that question to our program folks.
And so a good way to follow up there would be when you're having that conversation with your local agent, just to specifically ask what they need on down the road and make that decision then. Okay, so another thing that was, I'm not seeing another question. If y'all have more questions, go ahead and drop them in there. We do have a few more minutes for conversation here. One question that I had that was new, that I learned a lot about in the past few years were sort of the programs you have available for managing livestock, everything from like a high use road or thoroughfare to like cost share for feeders or watering areas, that kind of thing. Could you just give a few examples of what you all have available, programs you have available for livestock considerations?
Yeah, those are all great options. You know, again, with livestock, what we look at is, you know, how are they rotating on the landscape and soil condition on the property? And so it could range from, you know, helping to install cross fencing so that we can get the livestock impact reduced onto the lands and give the land some time to rest. It could be seeding coming in on those areas that are being rested to increase the forage and biomass and increase the diversity of plants that may be more palatable for the animals. It could be livestock watering systems, crossings, if you've got waterways that need to be crossed, you know, whether that would be needing to rock armor them or to some type of other crossing are all examples. If you have a pond and you're concerned about the water quality of that pond, we can help to maybe fence it out to get the cattle out of the pond so that they're not standing in it all summer, and that may help with the water quality and also the pond lasting a little bit longer as well.
Great, thanks for that. Mm-hmm. I think another program that you spoke about that I just want to highlight for the benefit of everyone here is the pollinator habitat and hedgerow. Those, I know we talked about the hedgerow, but the pollinator habitat specifically is part of the organic system plan. You're supposed to include biodiversity in your farming plan, right? That's like what, if you have a certified organic operation, it's one of the things you have to do. And here's NRCS with a program that like really helps you do that. And we've got a few farmers that are OAK members who've done really big pollinator installs or have them in the works. And maybe their operation is already certified organic, or maybe it's part of their 5-year plan. But I just really want to encourage people to take a look at that. I know that Jennifer, sometimes with that program, the preparations that folks have to do to the land can potentially involve an herbicide application to get that land ready. And around organic certification, there's some questions and answers and conversation that has to happen there. So it's a great example of if you're working with a local agent and you come up with some hard questions about, do I need to apply this or do I not, or what are my options? Have those conversations with your agent and feel free to ping Jennifer and bring her in on it, because she's walked through the process on a few farms at this point. But it's just a really great resource to get that biodiversity into your farm. That was my last plug for the pollinator program. I love that one. So
I did see that Sonia went back and answered the Schedule F question for me. Thank you, Sonia.
Oh, great. Yeah, can you mention that? Yeah.
It's no longer required for our cost share program that we're talking about today, environmental quality incentive program. So
great.
Things change with Farm Bill. So every 5 years, these things sometimes shift a little bit. There is a cost share program for compost pads and systems. That's a great question. That is also covered under our environmental quality incentive program. So that program is a pretty well encompassing program for most things that you're looking at doing on an organic operation.
Great. And is there a on-farm energy initiative?
Yes. That's also covered under the same program.
Okay.
So any type of energy conservation you're looking at doing, we have another conservation activity plan that helps to walk the property specifically to do with energy, looks at what practices could be installed, what could be improved upon. It'll look at your current usage and reports, and then what the payback time would be for any type of investment that you would want to install to make sure it really makes sense to improve whatever part of the facility you're looking at. But it'll look at the full facility and give you options for all of that. And then you can decide whether or not you want to continue with looking at funding for that.
Wonderful. Well, if anyone has any final questions, go ahead and drop them in the chat. Or applause for Jennifer. Go ahead and show her that with your reaction or drop it in the chat. There you go. Yay. I think I just want to summarize with, like, clearly there are so many programs that NRCS offers. Like, there's no way that any one of us could know them. So get your agent out to your farm, develop that relationship, ask your questions, be a fierce advocate for what practices you want to use on your farm, and we'll get you connected with all those great programs that can help take your farm to the next level and conserve all those resources. So just as a reminder here, this the chat's been really active, and that's awesome. We will post a recording of the whole video and the resources in the agenda in Hoover. The recordings will be available after the event. We have to do a bit of processing editing before we upload those. So the recordings are going to be available on desktop for 6 months, on mobile for a year. So you can go back to that. We're going to upload a PDF of Jennifer's slide deck. So you'll have the links there as well. You have Jennifer's email address and Sonia's email if you need to reach out, but really reach out to your local agent. Have I said that enough? and Jennifer, do you have any final comments for the group?
Thank you for all the feedback, all the commentary, all the questions. Appreciate that. It's always hard on these virtual conferences to know how engaged everybody is, but I'm glad everybody had a great opportunity to ask questions. Thank you to OAK for giving us this platform to get our information out there. So thank you for enjoying and
yay. Jennifer, thank you so, so much for being with us today. Look, everyone's clapping. Love it. Really appreciate the work you and the whole NRCS team does. It's been a great resource for OAK. We got initial support for our organic transition trainer program from NRCS through the Conservation Innovation Grant. And we wouldn't be doing the work we're doing out there with farmers if it weren't for NRCS and our partnership with y'all. So we really appreciate you. So thank you.